passion and purpose. We may be talking about marriages, but in talking about our marriages, they tie in to every relational issue that we have. One of the things that we must do, we must talk about what is the purpose for marriage. And you may be in here and you may not be married. Maybe you're growing up and you're in high school or college and you're thinking, I'm going to waste the next 40 minutes listening about marriage. And I'm going to tell you, unless we prepare our lives now for what we are going to have and become, you're going to wake up one day and say, I am not prepared for this topic. I am not prepared for marriage. And maybe you've gone through a marriage. Maybe you're divorced and you said, that stuff did not work. I'm telling you right now, we're going to give you some principles in the Word of God that's going to open up your heart. And you're going to say, only if I'd have heard that 10 years ago or 5 years ago, that could have transformed the way that we had our relationship. And maybe we can turn into and ask God to forgive us. And maybe we can start off fresh and new. But one of the things that we have to do is we have to understand this thing. I got to ask a question. Did God put you two together? Did God put you together? And if God put you together, what is the purpose of your relationship? What is the purpose of your marriage? And if I would ask somebody that and I said, did God put you together? And they'd say, yeah, God put us together. What's the purpose of your relationship?
I don't know.
In counseling, we sat in there, we'd ask that question, why are you guys together? What's the purpose of your marriage? And in most cases, they would look at me and say, I have absolutely no clue. We like each other. We don't fight. But we have to understand that there's a purpose behind what God does. And when God puts us together, we have to intently put upon our hearts, our lives, the purpose of God. So I want to give you some facts. Fact number one, in 5 years, you will not be the same person. 5 years, you will not be the same person. Better for some, worse for some. But the decisions we make, the attitudes that we have, and the conversations that we carry out, in 5 years, you will either be striving forward or you'll be falling backwards because of this one point. Time goes on, moves on. You have probably some of your good friends that have been married or that were getting married. 5 years ago, they were doing this, and now you look back and you wonder what happened to them. What went wrong in their life? Or you also see a couple that were about doing great, and all of a sudden something really wonderfully took place, and now they're thriving, striving for God, and everything's wonderful. And there's something in the midst that we're not going to be the same 5 years from now. What is our goals? What is our passions? What are our visions? The decisions you make right now will determine your future and what it'll look like in 5 years. The kids that you hang out in school right now, the ones that either make you happy or make you depressed, in 5 years from now, they're not even going to know your name. And sometimes we make kids our priority. And sometimes we have students that, well, they're not going to like what I do. They're not going to like this. You know what? When you get married, they're not even going to come to your wedding. Never allow someone to determine the outcome when you know that's what God wants you to do. Never allow somebody to suppress you and put you down. 5 years, we're not going to be anything like we are right now. Your friends, some of their lives will implode upon themselves because they do not have purpose. They do not have life. Fact number two, success only happens on purpose, never by accident. You never just fall into success. You never just say, oh, I think I'm going to be really good at marriage. I think I'm going to be really good at my job. I think I'm going to be really good at communication. If it does not take work, it will never be successful. You're not going to look up and say to your spouse, you know, we don't really talk a lot, but we get along pretty good. You know, we don't fight every day, so I guess we're doing okay. Everything that's going to be successful takes work, hard work. Fact number three, Success only happens when we are in agreement. Ooh. Now let's park here. Success only happens when we are in agreement. Amos 3:3. I'm going to read it, and then I'm going to use this verse quite a few times, and I would like to have classroom participation after you learn this verse, and it's a hard verse. I mean, it's hard. Here it is. Can two walk together unless they agree? Can two walk together unless they agree? Why are we together? What are we going to do? The deep things in life. Sometimes we just need to have premarital counseling right here and just talk about the things of life. Can two walk together unless they agree? About what? What should you have to agree on? Sometimes we can agree on where we're going to go on a date. Sometimes we can't even agree on what we're going to go eat. This is a bigger picture than that. Amos 3:3 talks about, can we get together? Can we be happy with each other unless we agree? Now, if you're looking back to these older couples, you know, the really old people, over 53, okay? If you're over, I mean, that's like, 53 is like, I mean, anybody under 53, they're just a young pup. If 53 is about the mark, 54 maybe next year, I don't know. But it's right there at the mark. You ask these wise old couples, they would probably tell you, agreement about the events and the issues of life are paramount to stay married. You may not like everything, but there's times that you're going to have to sit down and you're going to have to talk. This is one of the most important reasons why we have premarital counseling. We have premarital counseling for one purpose, and that's to talk, to agree. What do you want? What's your aspirations? What are your desires? Who are you serving? What is the purpose? And if young couples or older couples, if they do not have a purpose within their life, they're wandering around, not wondering what to do or what they're going to do, not where they're going to live, much deeper than that. It's a heart issue. It's a soul issue. Success happens when we agree, not any other time. To find the purpose in your life, you have to be asking the big questions. Why did God put us together? What did He have in mind putting us together? I don't know how many times I've been on this stage and had these couples coming up here one of the things that I love asking in premarital counseling before they get up on the stage is, do you believe God put you together? Do you believe it's not just happenstance and maybe you found each other and you met each other and you guys started talking, but did God put you together? Because if God didn't put you together, it is a very easy way to fall apart because there's not a focal point within the marriage. But if God put you together, then we can talk about everything. We can do the most important things. What did God have in mind is a very important question. You know, there was a poll out. If all the Americans were surveyed, they would have this one thing that if you could ask God any one question, and we're talking our personal life, ask God any question, the overwhelming majority answer was, what's your purpose for me? What am I here to do? I don't want to just live my life going through life and born and die and not have a purpose. One of the basic needs of our life is to have purpose, have a reason to be here, have a reason to go into my home, have a reason to have life. We have to have that reason. What is my purpose on this earth? Here Jesus was talking, and the Pharisees and the Sadducees came up to him, and they were trying to trick him about whether he knew the Bible. And they asked him, what is the most important commandment? And Jesus is going to give us the number one purpose of our life. And if we get this purpose down, we are going to have the opportunity to have a happy, personal and relational life. But it starts with this right here. It's found in Matthew chapter 22, verses 36 through 40. Teacher, which is the great commandment in the law? And Jesus said to him, Jesus speaking to all these religious leaders. These guys were the hated religious leaders. They treated everybody like junk, but they thought they were better than everybody else. They were trying to trick Jesus. They ultimately put Jesus to death. They didn't love Jesus. They weren't letting Jesus teach. They were trying to trick him into this question. All the commandments of the Bible, he boils them down to these two. The purpose of our life are boiled down to these two statements. Jesus said to him, you shall love Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. This is the first and great commandment. And the second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets. The Bible, they had the Pentateuch of the Bible. They had the law. And they said, if you understand the word of God and put the word of God in your heart, it is about love. It is the evidence of our salvation. It's the evidence of our Christianity when we live out love. We talk about love God with all your soul, with all your heart, and with all your mind. If you don't love, you don't understand the Bible. Because the Bible is about love. If we love people, then we will have an attitude towards people that are loving. Now, it didn't say we have to accept every person, but we have to love every person. We do not have to accept every lifestyle. We have to love the person within every lifestyle. We cannot condemn them from our relationships and not to allow them to see God because of a hateful attitude that we have. Sometimes the churches become arrogant in what we have, and in our arrogance, we repel people that need Jesus Christ. And the Bible says, love God with all your heart, soul, and mind. And the second is love others. And if we love others, we have the purpose of love. We have the understanding that I may not like everything that they do, but I love the person. And these two commandments hang all the law of all the prophets. You know, the Ten Commandments. The first four of those Ten Commandments is how we should love God. And the second, six, is how to love each other. It is very important to love. To love. A heartfelt love. Even in Genesis chapter 2, in the Garden of Eden, when Satan came in to tempt Eve. The Bible starts with that relationship. Adam and Eve in a perfect relationship, in a perfect environment with a holy God. The Bible ends with a perfect relationship in a perfect environment with a perfect God. It bookcases Genesis and Revelation with God in a perfect relationship. But the Bible has all kinds of stuff that goes in the middle of that. But Satan, he came in and he tempted Eve. Adam was there, but Eve took the road. Eve was tempted. And when Eve was tempted by Satan, it broke the relationship to man and woman. It broke the relationship from man and woman to God because it severed that relationship and it severed their dependence upon God. And from that day, from the earliest time of day when Adam and Eve broke that commandment and the relationship with God, Satan has always said this, I am going to destroy relationships because they didn't work together. They didn't talk about what needed to be done. They severed their union. They severed their love for each other and the relationship with God. And from that moment, Satan has always said, I can do it to them. I can do it to you. And sometimes we think our spouse is the problem. Satan, from the earliest time, said this, I hate marriage. Hate it. Because if the marriages are strong, I fail. I need to stand up and I am going to fight and I am going to do everything I can to put strongholds within marriages so they will not be happy and marriages will be destroyed. It's not your spouse. You may think it is. And I've met some of them and they may be close. but it is Satan. It's going to destroy. The devil is the enemy of all relationships. And when you stood before a preacher or a judge and you said, I do, what you're saying is, Satan, come on. Now what we have to do is we have to be very aware of who Satan is and what Satan wants you to do. The church needs great marriages. Marriage is the institution that thrives. Other institutions thrive with it. But when it fails, other institutions fail along with it. You can look at any church. You can look at any institution. If the marriages within that institution, if the marriages are in the church, if they're strong, the church is strong. But if the marriages are crumbling, there's chaos at home. There's chaos in the institution called the church. And you know, God established the marriage. He instituted marriage. It is his idea. And sometimes we take Satan's lies and we don't listen to what God has in plan for us. God, the devil, has a plan, and it's a very simple plan. It's a two-way plan. First thing he wants to do, he wants to separate. He wants the separation. He wants to get in the middle of your relationship. He wants to put seeds of doubt. He wants to put seeds of other things within your life. Jesus said to the disciples, you shall love your Lord, your God, with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. If we are captivated on God and we know the truth of God, we will not have separation. We know what we should do. We should know how to talk. We should know that God is in the foundation. God is centerpiece of our marriage relationship. And when Satan comes in and he tries to separate you, you can say, get thee behind me, Satan. I'm not listening to it. I know who I believe in, and I'm going to be faithful to God with all my heart, with all my soul, and with all my strength. When we can see the deeds of Satan and understand them, recognize them, and do not believe the lies that Satan wants to put in your way, because it starts very subtly. It may have start when you're a teenager, maybe when you're married, and somebody just says a seed of doubt. You know, I don't think you married the right person. If you didn't really have true love, if you don't feel loved, maybe you ought to just get rid of her. Get rid of him. Maybe the seeds that Satan puts in your heart and puts into your minds are not faithful to God, but faithful to the flesh. And the flesh really desires Satan's words. But the Spirit of God, the love, the joy, the peace, the long-suffering, the gentleness, the meekness, the temperance of God. That is the attributes of who we should be. Separation. Satan wants to separate your love from God and from your spouse. But then he does this, and this is where it all falls apart. Substitution. He wants you to substitute. He wants you to substitute things. See, the Adam and Eve were together, and Satan came up to her and said, you know, I know that you have this perfect environment and you have a wonderful husband, but, you know, that apple, that piece of fruit, that is what's going to give you happiness. That is what's going to give you enlightenment. If you have that, you can have everything. So Satan put into her mind a substitute. We're not Adam and Eve. We're not talking about a piece of fruit. But in our relationships, what is it that Satan is saying, I want to substitute? We, in our culture, sometimes we substitute our job for our spouse. Sometimes we substitute our identity in front of our spouse. Finances. We fight about all these things. We substitute our idea, our life, our happiness, our joy for stuff. And Satan is saying, if I can keep you fighting about stuff, you're not doing what God wants you to do, because God says, love your God with all your soul, mind, and spirit, and love others as yourself. He didn't need to say anything about stuff. He didn't say the purpose of your life is to gain stuff. He didn't say to get a bigger house, drive another car. He said, love God and love others. And if you love God and love others, that's the purpose of our life. We have to have a ministry mindset of God. Things will not make you happy. Things can make you miserable. If our focus is on things and our focus is not on God, then what happens? The devil wants you to think something will make you happy, not someone. Something. If I could just get that. And all of a sudden we're getting stuff. We're acquiring stuff. But our relationships are in turmoil. Our conversation, which doesn't exist. Satan creeps in and says, you know what? You ought to talk to them about the car, about your portfolio, and people that you're supposed to love are walking around dead with a relationship of no conversation. You substitute. Put something else in the place and you will be happy. So what do we do with that? When we know that Satan wants to separate and he wants you to have a substitution for your love to not only your spouse but to God, you have to have a vision. Vision for your marriage. Vision is letting God tell you what your purpose is. What is my purpose? And there's a scripture that we've used a lot, but it's a scripture that I've never used in weddings and in marriages, but it ties in so well. It says in Proverbs chapter 29, verse 18, where there is no vision, the people cast off restraint. Where there is no vision, where you don't know what you're doing, when you're in the dark and you don't have anybody to talk to and you're not talking to God, when we have no purpose, we have no vision, what happens? We just give up. We cast off restraint. We don't know what we're doing. We wander around hoping it's going to be okay. But without purpose, there will never be success. And without vision, you can't have purpose. You have no idea what you're doing and where you're going. Here's a paraphrase for that verse. When people who are together in a relationship do not have a common understanding and agreement for what God wants for them, it is impossible to keep them together in a productive manner. Is it possible to keep them together in a productive manner if they do not have vision, if they do not know where they're going, if they don't know what they're waking up to tomorrow, if they do not know what next month is going to be like, if they do not know what the plan is for next year, what they're doing is saying, how long is this going to last? What are we doing? And what happens if we do not understand what God is doing, we get tired, we give up, we quit because we have no vision. And in Amos chapter 3, verse 3 says this, can two walk together unless they what? Agree. We have to agree. We have to agree on life. We have to agree on what God wants for us. And when I say agree, we have to talk. We have to talk about what God wants. What's going on? You know, I say this in counseling, but this is so true. Everything's on the table. If we can't talk about everything, simple or gigantic, if we can't talk about everything, sooner or later, the thing that you will not talk about will destroy your relationship. Satan will get that little thing. He'll make it grow. And that thing that you will not talk about, you're too embarrassed to talk about, it may hurt you too much, will be the thing that destroys your relationship. When we are brought together by God, and God has given you a vision for the future, we cannot let unrooted, unsolved sin issues take over your life. There should be a day with a person that God has brought within your life. I'm talking about confession of your sins to every person in the world. That's between you and God. But the person that God is for you and that you believe God brought you together, there should be a day that you guys can have a cup of coffee, get a Diet Coke, Dr. Pepper, and sit out on the back deck of your house, take a couple hours, and do something most marriages don't do. Talk. Just talk. Because when you can talk, you can fix. But if somebody doesn't agree with that, but if you don't talk, it won't be fixed. There's no magic pills to fix the things. But in Genesis chapter 1, early, the Bible said, God said, let there be light. Then it was light. Vision is this within your relationship. God flipping the light switch on, letting you see clearly what God has in store for you. In the light, we can see. The difference is, Satan is the prince and the power of this dark world. He's the prince of darkness. He wants his deeds to be in the dark. And as long as he is in the dark, as long as he is not revealed, as long as he can keep creeping in and giving you those substitutions, as long as he keeps on creeping in and dividing you and separating you, and you do not see what he's doing, you will fall for his lies all day long. But when Jesus flips that light switch on and gives you clear, direct vision, Satan will scurry. Satan will leave. Because when the deeds are exposed, lies are exposed, truth holds on. What we must do is understand God's purpose, God's revealing light is vision. Being able to see clearly what God has in store for every one of our lives. Every one of our lives. So there's five virtues of vision. And they're very good. The first one is clarity. Clarity. Do you know why God put you together? How do you know if you're being successful if you don't know what success is? What is true accomplishment of success? Is knowing I am doing what God wants me to do. I married the person God wanted me to marry. I'm in a relationship with somebody that's doing what God wants them to do. And if we're doing what God wants us to do, the clarity is understanding God's word. What is the vision for the relationship? I believe the simple vision for the relationship is, number one, always putting God where he needs to be within that relationship. If you do not put God in the center of your relationship, your spouse does not put God in the center of their relationship, how can you walk together if you do not agree? The answer is impossible. Impossible. You're going to butt heads all day long. It is horrendous. Sometimes I do counseling with people that just definitely just do not see eye to eye on not some things, but I'm just like, wow. Really? Where'd you guys meet? I mean, wow. How could you guys even cross paths? You guys are so opposite. The magnetism. So, clarity. Confusion is the opposite of clarity. Confusion is the opposite of clarity. If confusion is the opposite of clarity, where will you be in 5 years if you are not clear, understanding? Where will you be 5 years if you're confused now? If you can't talk now? If you don't understand what you're doing now? 5 years. 5 years? That's a long time. That's a long time. If we are not clear on what we're doing, what God is doing within our life, 5 years is a long time. You're either going to be clear or you're going to be confused. The Word of God is the vision for our life. And the second thing is energy. Energy. I like using the word passion. You got to have passion. You know, passion for each other. Desire for each other. When there's passion and there's vision and you enjoy what's going on, it's there's excitement with us. And when somebody, even if you argue with passion. I mean, just whatever you do, do something with love, not passiveness. When you have energy and passion, that's the absolute trademark of having vision, because you want to be there. If one person says, I'd like to talk about the next 5 years and what we can do together and for God for the next 5 years, and one's all excited and thrilled about it, the other says, whatever, talk to me after the game, And always, talk to me later. I really don't care. There's no energy. That light switch must be turned on. How can we walk together if we do not agree? We cannot walk together. We must talk about our vision, our purpose, where we're going. We're not in a sprint. We are in a marathon. If it is a sprint, you don't have to talk. If you're going to live your life for 5 years, you can deal with 5 years standing on your head. But if you're looking at a 70-year fight, it's a marathon. It takes conversation. It takes work. It takes action. It takes energy. Habakkuk 2, verse 2 says this, "The Lord answered and said to write the vision and make it plain on tablets that he may run who reads it." Make it plain. And when somebody sees that vision and they understand that vision, they understand the purpose, they can see it, they can understand it, and I'm going to make it happen. I'm excited about what it is. And Jesus gave us that. He said, love God with all your heart, your soul, and mind, and love others as yourself. When we have that purpose within our life, it is the starting point for a happy, fruitful relationship. The third thing is purity. It is impossible to turn a negative thought into a positive action. It's impossible. Have you been around somebody that thinks on the negative? Man, I hope we make it this week. Man, I hope I don't get fired. They walk around in the negative. They walk around hoping everything's going to be okay. What we need in the pure thoughts, we need to think ourselves purity, and we say, it's going to be okay. I've asked God. God's on my side. I am going to claim the promises of God. I am not going to allow a negative thought to keep me in a negative place. If something negative takes place, I am going to turn that around and get into God's word and say, God, I need you to give me that reinforcement. I need you to turn that light switch on. We are not going to allow that negative thought. Where there is no vision, the people cast off restraint, but happy is he who keeps the law. Purity. You should not be worried about doing the wrong thing. You should be doing the right thing. Think about the right thing. You don't have to worry about something taking place within your life. You put your focus on God and do the right thing. We don't have to think about, oh, I hope this never takes place. I hope I don't ever do that. Well, cast that behind you. Think about what God wants you to do, and it won't take place. If you focus on negative, the negative can take place. If you focus on what God wants you to do in the positive, the negative is behind thee. And I love it. We need to get that in our vocabulary. Get thee behind me, Satan. In other words, I see your lies. I am not going to allow the lies of Satan to influence me one day longer. I'm going to focus on what God wants me to focus on. Have energy and have purity. And then fourth is unity. This is a big one. We need to get this one right here. How many of us have divisions sometimes in your relationships? Divisions. Two visions. I want to do this. You want to do this. I want to go here. You want to go here. You want to do that. I don't want to do that. Two visions. Whenever there's two visions, Luke chapter 11, verse 17, but he, knowing their thoughts, and said to them, every kingdom divided against itself is brought to desolation, and a house divided against house falls. We need to have the same vision. If we are not on agreement on the direction, destiny, and future, we're having division. Oh, it may be okay for a while. We can run the sprint. We can make it the first 5 years. Maybe 10 if we hide. But if we are in division, two visions, where there is no vision, the people perish. We need a godly vision within our homes. Can two walk together unless they agree? If there's divisions amongst you, there's two visions amongst you, we are not doing what God has asked us to do. Being unified is this. Nothing is impossible if you have one vision and it's God's vision. Nothing is impossible. How do we know what God wants you to do? We must pray. We must ask God. Say, God, tell me what you need. Tell me what I'm doing. Tell me how to act. Tell me what to do. And allow God's word to say, this family, I need you to be under one idea, under God's protection, under God's will. And he takes these two outside visions and bring them into one person. In Genesis chapter 2, verse 24, and this reason you should be called one. We are one flesh when we say I do. We have one purpose when we say I do. Put the divisions away. But here's what it is. The word provision, I like this one. Provision means for the vision. Where do we get our provision from? God. When we are supposed to be God's child and we have one family that we put God in and God put us together, now that we say I do, now we have two visions, he cannot provide outside of his will. But when we say, I want God's vision, God's purpose, and we do what God wants us to do, honoring him in every area of our life, he will provide in every area of our life. Sometimes finances are a major issue. Sometimes we struggle when we don't have God's vision. Sometimes you say, where's God? What's going on? And I'll tell you this. When you seek God's face for your vision, for your kids' vision, when you get on your knees before God and say, God, I need you. I need you to take care of this. I need you to take care of my kids. I want God's vision for my life. I want the light switch to be flipped on. I want you to see what I'm seeing. I want you to do some things for me. I want to be under your protection. And he said he would provide for us if we do what he has called us to do. Division. Two visions. Provision. One vision. Providing for the vision. If we have focus on God and we allow God to take care of us. And then the fifth is victory. Is victory. You know, in Proverbs chapter 29, verse 18, it says, where there is no vision, the people will scatter. But in the Message version, I want you to listen to this in the Message version. If people can't see what God is doing, they stumble all over themselves. But when they attend to what he reveals, they will be most blessed. You're going to stumble all over the place if we don't know what God is asking you to do. But I said this in counseling this week. But once you know what God wants you to do, once you know the nuggets of truth and the ability of your knowledge to say, I know I need to have a vision. I know I need to put God where he needs to be. I know I need to stop this. And once we know it, Satan is going to try to destroy it. He is going to try hard to destroy you. He wants nothing less than a pure D catastrophe within your life, because we have divided visions. If people can't see what God is doing, they stumble all over themselves. But when they attend to what he reveals, light switch on, he sees it, you see what he wants you to see, then they are most blessed. When you get a vision, you will succeed. When you do what God has asked you to do in your relationships, you will succeed. But God is not a respecter of persons. If God is not honored, if you do not seek his face, you do your own thing. You don't care what God asks you to do. It's like a man that does not respect gravity and he jumps off a building. But I'm a Christian. God protect me. God save me, but I'm going to jump anyway. Guess what's going to happen to that guy? He's going to fall flat off that face, flat off that building on his face. He's a Christian. God save me, but the laws of gravity are sure. God's laws are even more sure. They are truth. They are God's protection. When you're on the same team, you'll talk about everything. Not maybe about the things that you got hurt in the past. Those things were already talked about. But I'm saying talk about everything. Talk about work. Now, let me give you a list of the last 2 weeks. I've had 6 or 7 couples come in the office. I'm just going to be really honest with you. You know, they didn't talk about money. You know what the first thing people talked about? Sex. Number one, sex. Oh, we don't want to talk about that. Is it ruining your marriage? Yeah. But you don't want to talk about it? You're going to throw your marriage away because you won't talk about it? If it's you two talking, turn your stinking chairs around, face each other, cry with each other, and talk about it. We can't have anything within the marriage relationship that we are not strong enough to ask God to work within our marriage. It happens. The second is finances. Oh, I don't know. I don't know. I don't want to talk. I'm making mad. Well, you're spending the money. He's spending the money. Talk about it. Don't throw your marriage away because you're too afraid to talk about money. If you make it, you make it. Budget it. Spend it. Put God where he needs to be in it and let God bless it. Then we talk about children. And then we talked about jobs. And then we talked about putting God where he needs to be in these things. If we have a vision from God, but yet we can't talk about our issues. We're saying, God, I want you to bless, but I'm too arrogant to talk. I'm too shy to talk. I say, God, I need you. But what I have to do is I have to say, these are the real issues of life. And I love you. I love you with my whole heart. There should not be one thing that we cannot talk about. Everything's on the table. And when everything's on the table, here's what you can do. You can develop the strategy to have success. And you have to know who the enemy is. And the enemy is not your spouse. Satan hates you. He wants to ruin you. He has ruined many lives over the last 5 years that you know of, that I know of. Lives that are broken apart, that's major catastrophe, and it stinks. It hurts. There's nothing I can do. I just want to grab my arms around them and help them and love them and cry with them and pray with them because it's devastating within their life. But what I'm saying is now. Now is a brand new day. Now is a day the light switch could be turned on. We could say, God, give me that vision. Give me that purpose. Give me the reason. And turn our hearts towards each other alone and say, can we talk? I love you. And if we can say this, I love you. There's nothing you can tell me that I would not love you. I love you. We need to fix us. We need to fix our relationship. We need to fix our relationship with God. We need to have a vision from God and protection of God, and we need to be provided for because we're doing what God wants us to do. Marriages were built by God, but they're being ruined by man. They're being ruined by man. And the church was an institution built by God, brought in of humans, those that have believed in Jesus Christ and have come into the church. But with them come broken hearts, lives, and sin. And the church is supposed to be the lighthouse for God. But the homes are falling apart. Our lives are in chaos. And we are the body of Christ. How is the world supposed to see us walking in the light when we won't even ask God to flip the light switch on to make any changes in our life unless we humbly go before him, the body of Christ, those that love Jesus, and say, I need God. Turn that light switch on. I need the revelation, the enlightenment. I need to be able to see where Satan is lying, where his strongholds are, and I need to defeat that by seeing that, calling it what it is, using our spouse as the team in order to work together, the one that God has given to us, work together to fight for our vision. And then God will provide. He will. Our marriages, our relationships, we, the body of Christ, need to look to God for our enlightenment, our clarity, our passions, our energies, our purity, and our unity. And then we get to have victory. Let's go, Lord, in prayer. Dear Father, Lord, we come before you. Lord, many of us in this room need a touch from you. Many marriages are hurting, almost non-existent. They're just non-divorced. And Lord, that lie that they have lived, the pain that they have experienced, the scars that are so fresh, Lord, I ask you to turn on the light switch. Allow them to see the lies of Satan, the substitutes that they have put in their life for fulfillment that will never be satisfied. So, Lord, give them enlightenment. Give them peace. Give them understanding. Give them freedom from the shackles of sin. I pray that you'll protect them. I pray that when that enlightenment comes up, the vision is secure, the teamwork will take place, success will be started, and provision will be drained down upon them. But Lord, we need you. We need you to protect us, and we need you to love us. We thank you for that. In Jesus' name we do pray. Amen. Thank you.